I hear that you learn most from failure. If that is true, then I should know almost as much as God by now, because I have been failing for a long time. Actually, I have failed for 15 years. I have counted the years. It started when I was, an example very early was when I was 15 or 16 years old. I was heavily into disco dance music at that time. That was the 80s. And I wanted to write a newsletter about that music. And of course, this was the paper age, so I needed advertisers, and I went to the local retailers, but nobody wanted to work with me. That's a pity. Couldn't get that project going. But I had new projects on my mind already. For example, in the 90s, I worked with a friend of mine on converting macros from WordPerfect to Word, because many companies were migrating at the time to Microsoft Office products. And that worked for some time. We actually made some money. We were part of a bigger organization, a training company. But after a few years, the whole organization collapsed and took us with us. So that was a pity, but no problem. I had a new project already. I had a very popular website at the time. This was at the end of the 90s, in the upswing of the internet hype. And it was a website about computer games, and I earned lots of money with advertising. At that time, you could earn money with advertising. And I created a business plan, how we could grow that into a bigger company. And it was the most beautiful business plan that was created that year, because actually I won an award as Entrepreneur of the Year for the best looking business plan. All the graphs went up. Revenue went up, the number of employees went up. These were all the predictions that I made. And I was able to convince informal investors to inject 1 million euros into our little company. And for a year or two, we did our very best to spend that money to the last euro. But unfortunately, we couldn't find any customers. That was a bit of a problem. So I had already next projects on my mind. I tried to be a cartoonist, but I failed. I tried to write a book, a novel, but I failed. I have about 15 failed relationships behind me. Many projects failed. Until I started writing a blog, noop.nl, in 2008. And I did that for a few years, and I got more and more readers. And last year, there was this list, top 200 agile blogs in the world, based on Google rank, RSS subscribers, Twitter followers, and many more statistics. And they said, number one is Martin Fowler, number two was Mike Cohn, number three, there was me. Yay, I finally had a success. Oh, I was so happy. And the success of the blog turned into a book, Management 3.0. It is about the role of the manager in agile organizations, something that I am passionate about. They should change their behaviors to support the teams, the agile teams. So I wrote a book about that, and the publisher says it's doing well. It's been translated to Chinese and released a few weeks ago, and I just got a message yesterday that the first edition sold 2,500 copies in just 2 weeks. That's quite a lot. I'm quite happy with that. I can't read it. It's the first thing that I ever wrote that I can't read myself. That's awesome. But it's doing well over there. And I have a course based on the book, and it's also doing nicely. So I thought, this is interesting. I'm onto something here. And last year I had another idea that was to get people together in Europe and collaborate more about Agile and Lean topics, because I was at a conference in the southern part of Germany, was near the border with France and near the border with Switzerland. Play for Agile conference, it was called. And there were many people there from Germany, of course, but nobody from France and nobody from Switzerland. It was only a 2-hour drive. I was there from Holland, that was a 15-hour drive, but nobody from Switzerland, nobody from France. There were four people from Canada, For some reason, I have no idea why, sometimes I think there's some kind of wormhole between Canada and Europe, because I keep walking into these Canadian speakers like J.B. Raisberger and Robin Diamond and Janet Gregory. They're all around us here in Europe. But anyways, great people. But so we were wondering, why are our fellow Europeans not here from other countries? So we said we have to start Agile Lean Europe Network. And this was such a great success that half a year later we had a conference in Berlin with 200 people from 34 different countries. Another success. And some people asked me, how do you do that? There was actually somebody over lunch, Sven, I remember his name. He asked me, how is it possible? You have been a pathetic, miserable failure for 15 years. Well, actually, I think that's what he thought, not really how he phrased it, but I'm sure that's what he thought. And now you have a few of these successes in a row, and I don't know, maybe I already used up all the amount of failure that is available for me in the whole universe. There's nothing left. Maybe the blog had to have been a failure as well, but then some god out there said, no, you cannot have that amount of failure. There will be nothing left for the European government. So, I had a few successes, and I tried to learn from that. And I also matched this with the questions that I get in my courses, because I always ask at the beginning of my course, what is it that you're struggling with when you're trying to be agile in your organization? And many, many times people come up with these questions. How do I make the rest of the organization more agile? Business, account management, HR, etc. How do I motivate my employees, my fellow team members, to develop themselves some more? How do I convince customers that they should accept Scrum? Etc. etc. Every time it's the same question. How do I make sure that other people change their behavior, because I know what they should be doing, but they're not doing it. So this is about change management. And the basic question is, how can I be successful at influencing other people to do what I want? How can I influence them at reading my blog or coming to my conference or be agile? So that's a very important topic, and this is, for example, another proof that this is what keeps people busy, because this is from the State of Agile survey from version 1, a tool vendor. They released this just 2 months ago, and like in the previous editions, the previous years, the number one reason for failed Agile adoptions is the ability to change organizational culture. And the number three reason is a general resistance to change. Both of these have to do with change management, changing people's behavior. So it is no wonder that this is a hot topic in the Agile world. So I tried to research that. I like that idea of changing other people's behaviors, because I stopped changing my own behaviors. That's useless. I guess it doesn't get me anywhere. So I thought, let's focus on other people instead. And the question is then, how do I change a social complex system? Well, I was inspired by these books. Leading Change, Influencers, Switch, and Fearless Change. All four of them are great books. They have good models. Though I think the models are a bit simplistic, and I sort of mix them and turn them into something new. And I call them the four facets of social change, and I'm going to talk about that. I call that the mojito method, that is turning some ingredients that are in themselves somewhat boring, turning them into something that is amazing. And this is the mojito method applied to change management. I'm going to tell you what it means. It consists of four parts. The first part is consider the system. You have to be a systems thinker, or nowadays some people call it complexity thinker. You have to understand that you're working with a complex system, and the system responds to what you're doing, and then you respond to the system, and it responds back, and this goes on and on and on. Second, I'll go into detail in a moment. Second, consider the individuals. They're all different human beings. They have to change at the personal level. And simply making people aware of a need is not enough. You have to also address the emotional side. Third part, it is like a virus that you're trying to inject into the system. You want the good behaviors to be copied by everyone. So that's the third part, the network aspect of it. And the last part is the boundary, the environment. We always talk about self-organization in Agile. Well, self-organization can only happen within a boundary, is what the scientists say. Well, sometimes you can tweak that boundary. You can change it. That means the self-organization is going in a different direction. All right, let's go into detail. So this was the overview, now the details. The first part, I call it dance with the system. And I use the PDCA cycle for that. The good old PDCA cycle from Deming and Schuhart, the continuous improvement cycle. It's, I think, more than 70 years old by now. There have been many other versions. We sometimes call it inspect and adapt in the Agile world. Nowadays, with the lean startup movement, they call it build, measure, learn. It makes no difference. To me, it's all the same thing. You do things iteratively. Start with plan. First one. What is your goal and where is it going well? These are the two questions that you have to ask yourself if you're a change agent. For example, the Agile Manifesto. 17 people got together a bit more than 10 years ago, and they shared with each other what was going well for them in their projects. They shared these stories, they came up with some generic principles, and then they said, okay, let's start changing the world. Let's copy that to other people's projects. So they had a vision and they understood where things were going well. We had something similar with the Agile in Europe network. We saw that things were going well if we were together sitting in a bar and drinking beers. Well, in my case, mojitos. But if everyone was having fun and sharing stories. And then we got these amazing projects started. Like, oh, let's do a conference about games or something. Et voila, a new conference was born. These things happen when you're together in a bar having a drink and enjoying a good time. So we said, this is going well. This is the kind of behavior we have to copy across Europe. Get people together and share drinks and stories. Second part is do. What are the crucial steps and when and where do you start? Because there can be a best time and a best place to start with your changes. But first of all, what are the crucial steps? Like the task board. This is a very, very simple step for people to make. This is what they came up with 10 years ago. Though I admit this is a bit of a strange one. It says beer, cake, play football. So apparently this is somebody planning to be at a party or at the beginning of a party evening. Then I can imagine this person having lots of beers in front of him at the table and some cakes and then etc. And then really committing to having that finished by the end of the evening and then start eating and eating and drinking until by the end of the evening everything should be done, right? Everything should be done. And then you show that to the host. Look, this is I'm done, I'm completed. And then you move the sticky notes across the board and you say this is Scrum basically. Some people say, you should not be doing that. The previous keynote speaker this morning said, you should not all do all those estimates. Maybe some people say, I'm not going to estimate, I'm just going to say, I'm going to drink as fast as I can. I'm drink and drink and drink, but one drink at a time. We call that countdown. But it's the same thing. It's moving stuff across the board, sticky notes across the board. How simple can it be? So that's crucial for the do part, simple steps. Then, check. What are the results? How do you get feedback? And how do you measure the results? Are the questions that you have to ask yourself. Like in my courses, I always use a happiness door or a feedback door. I have people put sticky notes on the door, and by the end of the first day, or even if I do it by lunch on the first day, I already know what the general mood in the room is and what I can improve. If I wait for the feedback forms at the end of the course, it is too late. I cannot change the course anymore that I'm doing. So I increase the speed of the feedback cycles. And the last part is, how do you accelerate results? How do you make sure that you're prepared to do this again and again? My favorite example is the iPad. This is not a new invention. There were 15 attempts at creating a tablet computer before the iPad, including Apple's own failed Newton, for example. But I'm quite sure Apple learned from all those previous failures. There was lots of interesting data to learn from for the iPad. And this is what you have to do as a change agent as well. Be prepared to cycle through this again and again and again. So it is a social system, and it is complex and adaptive. And you have to keep poking it with ideas. Some of them will fail, sure, but you'll simply try another one. And then the system responds, and it changes, and then you figure out if you're going in the right direction. And this quote by Donella Meadows, a systems thinker, is one of my favorites. She said, we cannot control systems out or figure them out, but we can dance with them. I love that. We can dance with the system. It's a great metaphor. So she basically said that here's the system, and you want that system to move over there, so you start dancing. And you're dancing, and then hopefully you're moving in the right direction, but suddenly the system does this. You think, oh my God, no, I don't want to go in that direction. I want to go over there. But if you're a good dancer, then hopefully, yes, you're going in the right direction again. Maybe the system has a new idea, and then you go like this. And this can go on and on. Now, if you train to be a better dancer, then you can move in the right direction, and you end up where you want to be. If you're a bad dancer, you end up somewhere else. And yes, it might involve some bruised toes and blue elbows, etc. But this is part of what it means to be a change agent. It's fun, by the way. Last year at the XP conference in Madrid, Brian Merrick, who's one of the signatories of the Agile Manifesto, he did exactly the same thing. He said exactly the same thing. He compared it with dancing the tango. So he let everyone stand up and grab the partner next to him or her and dance the tango. So he made me dance the tango with Lasse Koskela, a speaker from Finland. So I was very, very glad at that time that it was Lasse, because people from Finland are very, very silent. So I hoped he would keep his mouth shut about it. Unfortunately, now on his Twitter page, he has, "I once danced the tango with Jurgen Appelo," so everyone can see it. You can check it. That's true. So never trust people from Finland. At least not dance with them. That's my conclusion. Anyways. So if you have something that you want to change, like I want my organization to be more agile, you have to ask yourself some questions. What is my goal, and where are things going well? And what are the crucial simple steps that we have to start out with? How do I get feedback? How do I measure results? And am I prepared to do this again and again and again and accelerate the change? Dance with the system. That was part one. Part two. This is about the people. Mind the people. Oh, here we go again. I know exactly what you're doing. All right, mind the people. They are they are the parts of the system, and they have to change at the individual level. There's a model for that too. It is called ADKAR, a model for personal change, and it starts with awareness. This is communicating to people what the change is about, and you can do that good, and you could do that badly. Susanna has just had a session about communication. It is a very interesting topic. How do you set the right example? I like this example. Our government pretends that they want us to stop smoking by having these messages on cigarettes. Smoking kills. Of course, they really don't want us to stop smoking, because they would lose a lot of money on tax if they would stop smoking. But anyways, this is creating awareness about smoking. But it's not enough. This won't change people's behaviors, because it's just the first part of the model. You need to do more than that. That's what the second part is about. Desire. This is about making sure that it feels urgent, making sure that it feels desirable. For example, I was in Rio de Janeiro last year, doing a course over there in Brazil, And I was sitting in the bar enjoying one of the 40 different fruit juices that they have over there. I love that about Brazil. Watching television, but I don't speak Portuguese, so I could only look at the interesting imagery. And there was a soap opera going on. And I saw the basic pattern of the soap opera, of the Brazilian soap opera. It went like this. People fighting, then there was a bit of kissing, then they were fighting, a little bit more of kissing, and they were back to fighting again. I thought, my God, that's brilliant. This is so amazing. They really understand what we like looking at, what we like watching. Just think of your neighbors. At which point is it interesting to watch your neighbors? When they're fighting or when they're kissing? At other points, it is not interesting to watch your neighbors, I can tell you. This is basic intrinsic desires, human desires. I researched that. There are different models for intrinsic desires. There's the Maslow pyramid. There's the three desires of drives of Daniel Pink's book Drive. There's the self-determination handbook, etc., etc. I came up with this list of 10 intrinsic desires. I ordered them in such a way that they have an acronym that says CHAMP frogs. I have no idea what CHAMP frogs are, but I think it's a nice word. And I like this scale because I can compare it with any change initiative that I'm doing. When I'm trying to change people's behavior, I'm trying to figure out in what way am I trying to target their intrinsic desires. I'll give you an example. This is one of the best Dutch inventions ever. They have these urinals at Schiphol Airport. Now they have them all over the world in many different forms, but these were the first ones, with a little fly in the urinal. You can imagine what kind of problem they had at the airport, in the men's room. So just imagine that you're a man. That might be difficult for some people in the audience I see here. But just imagine that you're a man and you're standing there and you look at the fly and you think, am I able to flush away the fly? That's curiosity. That's one point on the CHAMP frog scale. Other people might think, am I able to hit it right between the eyes? That is mastery. That's the second point at the CHAMP frog scale. While other people might think, ha-ha, say goodbye to the world, little fly. That's power. That's the third one. That's at least 3 points on the CHAMP frog scale. That's an amazing invention. Of course, it has absolutely nothing to do with keeping the room clean, which is the original need, apparently, that they had. But they attached something, they did something that made it desirable. So you have to think about these things as well as a change agent. I heard that they're exporting these toilets all over the world now, but they're customizing them, like the ones that go to the United States. They have they don't have a little fly, but they have a tiny version of the Canadian flag there. Right. Okay. Poor Canadians. I love them. Really, I do. Knowledge is a third one. We're good at this. This is about mentors and coaches and gurus and consultants and everyone who can help you trying to do a good job. And we have all these references to the martial arts in China and Japan because they're so good at over there at that coaching and mentoring people. So we know what to do here. So let's skip this level and go to the next one. This is about ability. So people are aware of the need to change. They desire the change. They know how to do it because they're getting help. But then ability might be a problem. Something is holding them back. Something is preventing them from change. As a change agent, you have to make sure that you remove all the obstacles. Make sure that anything that is keeping them, holding them back, is removed out of the way. Like I like this example from Amazon, the buy now with one click button. It is after the red button in the White House, the most dangerous button in the world. I'm serious. I have been warning people for half a year against this button, and I clicked on it last month. I wanted to store a book in my wish list, and I accidentally clicked on buy now with one click. Damn, I had bought the book. I'm glad it was just a book and not an airplane. But anyway, so it works. They had removed all the obstacles and it was just one click. This makes it easier to get people to move in the right direction. With other change efforts, like getting everyone to do Scrum, for example, it's a bit similar. Scrum is quite easy to get started with. Just a few roles, just a few processes. That's basically it. It's very hard to do it well, it's very hard to do it right, but it's easy to get started. And it's even easier to start with Kanban, people tell me, because you don't even have to change the roles anymore. You just put up a board, have a limited work in progress, and there you go. You're doing Kanban. It's awesome. Again, hard to do it well. Then the last part is about reinforcement. I'm quite sure some of you, like me, have at the end of the year these New Year's resolutions. Like, this year I'm finally going to work out. This year I'm finally going to give a compliment to my spouse. This year I'm finally going to call my mother. These things that we promise ourselves. Maybe in the first few weeks we can live up to our own promises, but then in February we're back into old habits again. Things are back to normal. This is very typical when we want to change our behaviors. So how do we prevent that? Well, with short-term wins. The short-term wins keep us motivated. But also with some things that make it sustainable. Some people, they hook up their Nike shoes to their smartphones and then start working out against each other over the internet. They make it competitive, they make it playful. Gamification is all the rage in the last few years. This is how people make their behavior sustainable. So that's something that you have to think about as well. This was the second part of the model. This was about individuals and just sending people a rational message, like starting next Monday, everyone will be on time in the meetings. Yeah, right. That's not going to happen. It may create awareness if they read the email at all, but it's not targeting anything else in that model. So if you have some questions for yourself. If you have some challenges for yourself, I mean, like I want everyone to adopt behavior-driven development, for example, or I want my developers to educate themselves some more. Well, ask yourself these questions. How will I communicate? How will I set an example? How can I make it urgent and desirable? Is there somebody to teach them? And can I make it easy? Can I remove all the obstacles? And are there any short-term wins that keep motivating us or other ways that we can make it sustainable? Difficult questions that you have to ask yourself. That was the second part. Third part of the model. Stimulate the network, I call it. Remember, this was about injecting a behavior in the network. You want everyone to copy those new behaviors, those new ideas. Well, surprise, surprise, there's a model for that too. It is called the adoption curve, the innovation adoption curve by Rogers, a very famous model. And he said basically when a social system changes, it follows a curve across a number of different kinds of people. It starts with innovators and it ends with the laggards, and there are three groups in between. And actually, I think there's a group in front of it. They are the initiators, the igniters. That's you, the ones who want everyone else to change. And they have to ask themselves a few questions, like, are you really committed? Are there people helping you? Some people call them a guiding coalition. Do we have a guiding coalition of friends and other initiators who want to do this together with you? Like, this is a famous change agent. He even got a Nobel Prize just for the idea of changing the world. He didn't do anything, he just had an idea. Wow, Nobel Prize, fantastic. I had the same idea, I didn't get the Nobel Prize. Very strange. But anyways, he has a guiding coalition there. and people helping him out, and he's quite committed. I'm quite sure about that. These are my heroes, or some of my heroes, people who helped me out with the Agile Lean Europe network. And it was important to have somebody to share emails with, a shoulder to cry on when people would be unkind to me. This happens sometimes. So this was my guiding coalition. But then you start with the real curve. The innovators, this is the first group. They are the most important ones to focus on at first, because they are the most eager. If it is about the tablet computer, for example, the iPad, they stand in line for hours to be the first to purchase the iPad. They want it desperately. And you spoil them, you give them special attention, you treat them very, very well, because they have to get the whole cycle started. This was my book launch last year. These were my innovators, the people in the room who were prepared to travel to Rotterdam to attend my book launch. They were my innovators. I gave them special attention. Very important. Then, the early adopters. This is the second group. This is an important group because there can be leaders among them here. The hubs in the social network. Once they hear about something and they're positive about it, they will copy it to everyone. They are like airports. They broadcast viruses to everyone who come there. So this is an important group, and you have to understand who these early adopters are. Who is it that you have to get on your side? Fortunately, I didn't go into too much trouble, because there were several leaders like Rachel Davies, Lisa Crispin, JB Rainsberger, who happily applauded when we started with the Agile in Europe network. And these were the hubs in the social network. They broadcasted around them what we were doing and giving it more attention. Then it gets difficult, because then you get to the early majority. And these people have different ideas. They're not interested in the iPad because it is from Apple. They couldn't care less. They have a different need. They just want to see Sex and the City on the train. That's a very different requirement. And you have to understand how that group is different from the first group. And some people can't. They only address the first ones who are very enthusiastic. And then the idea drops in the chasm, they call it. It is unable to climb out. So there's a chasm here between the early adopters and the early majority. To prevent your idea from dropping in the chasm, you have to think forward and think about that next group. For example, I've been thinking about Kanban. I think it's somewhere along the early adopters group at this time. It hasn't crossed to the majority yet. And sometimes I think, it might be difficult for the majority because they have very difficult terminology. Limited work in progress and classes of service and many other difficult words that are not that interesting for the majority. On the other hand, I think, it could be actually very easy, because you don't have to change anything to do Kanban. You just put something. You put a board on the wall. As compared to Scrum, Scrum requires you to have different roles. It is a restructuring of the organization, so that actually makes it easier. So I think the jury is still out on Kanban, whether or not they will be easily able to cross the chasm. Then the skeptics. These are the ones that think, I don't believe in it. I don't think that's going to work. The iPad, that's just four iPhones taped together. makes no sense. It's a ridiculous idea. I thought exactly the same thing. I'm honest, but by now I have a tablet computer. So apparently I was a skeptic, but I have been convinced. And the important message here is that you have to listen to them. What are they saying, those skeptics? Can you learn something from them? Some people were skeptical when I started with the Agile Lean Europe network. They said, Jurgen is just trying to get customers all across Europe. It had not even crossed my mind. How do they come up with something like this? It will never work. This is not how self-organization works, somebody told me. Okay, we'll see. But that was useful feedback. I could learn from it, because we then tweaked our message, and that made us more successful. Then we get to the last group, the laggards. This is a difficult group because they will resist in any way they can. There's just one thing you can do, and there's hope that they die. Or leave the company, or something like that. Some of them might be convinced in the end, or trampled by the majority. Basically, you have to ignore them. But there's one important message here that I picked up from the change agent experts. Some people think that they are done when they're here. And then they cry, yay, victory, we've done it. The majority is now on our side. But you're not ready yet, because the laggards are still there. And unfortunately, with some people, some agile coaches, for example, they then leave the company, or they go somewhere else. Okay, we're done. Next organization to transform into agile. And then the laggards rise. And they undo all the work that has been done before. This is very interesting if you're an agile coach, because you can start all over again with the same company. But for ethical reasons, perhaps not what you're after. So don't stop too soon. You have to keep monitoring things, is what they say. Otherwise, the whole building will burn down. So this is the third part. The interactions, you want that virus to spread across the network. And you have to keep monitoring, where are we in that curve? What is the next group going to ask from us in terms of actions? All right. So the questions that you should ask yourself is, am I committed? Who is assisting me? Who are the innovators? Who are the leaders among the early adopters? And how is the majority different from those earlier groups? And am I actually listening to the skeptics? Do I take them seriously? And will I not go out of there too soon? Am I able to go through it all the way to the end? Fourth part, change the environment. This is about the boundary, as I said. Ilya Prigogine was a professor in Belgium, and he came up with this idea that self-organization cannot even exist if there is not a boundary to steer it. So you can tweak that boundary. There's a model for that too. It is called the five I's. Actually, it was the four I's, but I added this one. Infrastructure, first of all, because I think it's different, and second, because now I can legitimately call it my own model, which is useful. So the five I's, it starts with information. We're good at that in the Agile community. Information radiators. You can really influence people's behavior with information radiators. Put things on the walls, have red lights going off when somebody broke the build and flash their name. He did it. And then he has to wear the hat with the fluffy bunny ears for at least a day. These are information radiators that will change people's behaviors. Here's an example from traffic. I read an article in Wired magazine just a few months ago. They said that this works very well. The speed limit is 25, you're going 48. Whoops, sorry. I didn't realize that, going too fast. They said this works much better than police cars hidden behind billboards. And nobody even gets a fine here. But statistically, it has a much better effect. So this is a typical information radiator. You simply confront the system with the intended behavior and the current status. We did something similar with the Agile in Europe network, though it is hard to have an information radiator with just a website. But one of the most popular pages was this one, with all the countries that where we had registered attendees, and people were looking at the map all the time and trying to figure out which countries are missing, and do we know anyone there? Can we invite them, and can we make it easier for them to join us? So this rapidly grew into 34 different countries. It had an effect. Number two, identity. This is harder. This is about the identity of the team or the identity of the organization. As an example, this is a picture of a typical Dutch family. Yes. I'm sorry about that. So this is how my fellow countrymen walk around on the 30th of April when we celebrate Queen's Day. I have no idea why we should celebrate that we have royalty. But anyways, that's what we do. And when there's a big international football match, same thing. So what happens here is peer pressure. you're expected to walk around like that and be weirder than the others, of course, with all kinds of silly references to Dutch culture, like wooden shoes and windmills and whatever. This is a higher identity that people are associating themselves with at that time. It works. And you can have that in organizations too. Some of them are very, very good at it. The likes of Apple and Google, where they have certain things that they do because we are Apple, because we are Google. That's how we do things around here. And that changes people's behaviors. So some way or another, you have to achieve something like that too on your team, give it an identity, or your organization, turn it into a strong identity. Of course, the Netherlands is not the only country that walks around in funny clothes. This is a picture I found of a family in Canada. Yeah, keep picking on a Canadian, sorry about that. I use the same mechanism with the Agile in Europe network. Because basically what I said is, we're not America. We're not America. We have our own problems here in Europe. Because we have many different languages, we have many different cultures, and we have to learn how to work together. And that is really hard. And what are we doing? We keep inviting American keynote speakers. They're great guys, I know them personally, but we keep inviting the Americans and come and tell us what to do. That doesn't make much sense, because some things we know much more about in Europe. And you know what? People said, yeah, we're Europeans. We have our own problems. We're going to solve it ourselves. They didn't really say screw the Americans, but that really was like, yeah, we're Europeans. Positive, keep positive there. And that worked. This was an identity thing. For example, this logo here, the logo that is intended to be a Belgian beer glass, though the French, of course, see a wine glass here. And the British tend to see the Holy Grail. This is intended to be a beer glass. This logo was turned into a sticky note version, sticky art, during the conference. I have never been at a conference before where people were creating a sticky note version of the logo. Identity at work. Does anybody have this bracelet, the green bracelet, clean code? Anyone? One? Yeah? Good. Well, I think Uncle Bob still has some evangelization to do here in Latvia. So this is the idea that programmers have this bracelet, clean code bracelet, that is supposed to steer their behavior, because you're a clean coder, you do things well. So you type on your computer and you're creating software and you think, I don't have time to write a unit test for this, I'm just going to ship it as it is. But then you see this clean code bracelet, you think, oh my God. Uncle Bob is going to kill me if I do that. So you will write the unit test anyway. This is identity. And I hope it works, but apparently we need more green bracelets over here. Okay, almost there. Incentives. There's a third eye of the five eyes model. This is how we teach children. This is how we train animals, with small rewards for good behavior. Keep in mind, small rewards. So we don't give our children 1,000 euros when they earn a high grade at school. No, we give them a compliment, a hug, a movie ticket, whatever. Keep the reward small. And also reward good behavior, because outcomes can be cheated more easily. It is better to reward good behaviors. We can do this in organizations and in teams as well. Infrastructure is the fourth one. This is about the physical infrastructure. I have Schiphol Airport as my favorite example, where they are masters at manipulating people and moving them in the direction of the gates, maybe first to the shops and then to the gates. This is what they're trying to do, and they're quite good at it. Last one is institutions. This is about the self-organizing institutes that are able to set some rules for good conduct. Like, here's a picture of the guilds in Brussels, the Brussels Market Square. The guilds in Europe were self-organized entities that set rules for people. If you're a carpenter in this region, then these are the rules for carpenters. Otherwise, you cannot be a carpenter. We're going to chop your head off. That was sort of the consequence, I believe. But in an organization, we can have something similar. The communities of practice, for example. Communities of practice can tell people, this is how we do testing, the testing community of practice. This is how we do testing. These are the rules for testers. I just learned from Joachim that at Spotify they actually call the communities of practice guilds over there. It's the same thing. So that was the last part of the model, the environment. Behavior is a function of a person and his or her environment, and if you change, if you cannot change the person, then change the environment. That might be much more effective. Now, very important, this last quote that I'm bothering you with. You saw that problem at the beginning, organizational culture, the number one obstacle for agile transformation. Sometimes the question that I get literally is, how do I change my organization's culture? Well, the answer is by doing everything that I just talked about for the last hour. It is not like item one on a checklist. Oh, let's change organizational culture next Monday, and then item two is introduce agile or whatever. No, that's not how it works. It's a lot of work, and the outcome is a changed culture. So John Cutter says culture changes only after you have successfully changed people's behaviors, and when a new behavior has achieved the group benefit for a period of time. So, last questions that you have to ask yourself: how do I radiate information? How can I ease communication? And is there a group identity, team identity, organizational identity that I can attach my new idea to, so that everyone understands, now that I'm part of this group, this is what I'll have to do. Can I incentivize group good behaviors? Can I remove some barriers or put some guides in place, work with the infrastructure? And are there any entities, institutions that can make some rules for good conduct? So I call this Change Management 3.0 as a tongue-in-cheek reference to the book, because this is not in the book. I came up with this afterwards. And it is about continuous change, continuous improvement, change at the personal level, change the environment, and also follow the curve when you're trying to change the whole system. I turned it into a little book of about 80 pages. You can find it here at management30.com/how-to-change-the-world, or you can email about it if you want. It's available on lulu.com. And my final two comments: there will be a new ALE conference in Barcelona. Yes, I'm promoting it right now. I'm using the stage. I hope I'm allowed to do that. So I hope to see you in Barcelona at the end of August. I'm sure it will be amazing. And there's also going to be a course here in Riga at 4th and 5th of September, Management 3.0 Agile Leadership Practices course. So that's it. /share, you can find all these slides. I just updated them to the latest version this morning. You can find me on Twitter, my blog, and the book is on management30.com. Thank you very much for listening, and